Mercy, and we're glad you are here to worship with us. I have got so much to talk about this morning. It has been an amazing past couple of weeks, and I will start with today. We want to invite you to Pastor Ed and Carmen's class at 11:15. They are studying spirit, soul, and body, so you are welcome to stay and attend that. And also pick up your new daily bread for September, October, November. They are on the table at the back of the sanctuary. They are also on the foyer table. So be sure and pick up this. It's already September 1st, this coming week. So you will want your daily bread to keep up with your daily devotionals. We had the fair booth and we had Vacation Bible School. And if you were involved in any capacity for either of those two events, would you stand, please? If you were involved with Fair Booth or Vacation Bible School, would you stand? These events, or ministries as they are better referred to, are a team effort. And the people of this church, I am so grateful, because you give your time, you give your talents, and because you do, the kingdom is increased. We had 5 children pray for salvation during Vacation Bible School. Yay! Now, that could easily be a result of someone going to the fair booth. It is a result of you putting in time and effort in all the areas of Vacation Bible School. And even if you weren't here physically or at the booth physically, you're still a part of it if you remember those ministries in prayer, if you give financially, you're all part of that result of the Holy Spirit moving and seeing people's lives changed. And I can't tell you how grateful I am for your participation in the work we do. As God uses us, He uses you to do His work. And thank you again. It's awesome. During Vacation Bible School, on the average evening, we had 32 kids in the building, 11 teens, and 24 adults. And I want you to see a couple pictures. These are windows right here. Okay, these are the teens who were playing nine square. This is one of the inflatables we had this year, the obstacle course. These are two boys getting ready to do the obstacle course on our finale night. These are some kids with their prizes from a game they had played. Here again, we have kids playing games at the finale. And here we have a couple of very serious cornhole players. They look like it's very important to them. And here we have a grip toss game. And this kind of looks like it was during the evening when we were here in the sanctuary singing songs and having our class lessons. So it was just really a fantastic time. And it went very, very well. Also, because of your generosity, we want to thank you. We had the Adult Teens Challenge Men's Choir here last Sunday. We collected $1,229 for the choir. We also had our blood drive on Wednesday. The American Red Cross was here. We had 16 donors, and they collected 12 units of blood. So thanks again for helping save lives. Awesome. And we're ready to move into Super Kids now. Super Kids is going to start on September 15th, meeting every Wednesday night, and it's for ages 3 through grade 5, And if you know any children who would benefit from being in Super Kids, please pass the word. I have a staff meeting tomorrow at 6 p.m. So staff members of Super Kids, that's tomorrow at 6 p.m. If you would like to be involved in Super Kids, we can certainly find something for you to do to help us out. So you're welcome to join us in that ministry. Again, we had kids pray for salvation last year in Super Kids. These ministries make a difference, and it's because of you. We have a salvation night in Super Kids. We have a salvation night in VBS, in which we just focus on that. And so again, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I can't thank you enough for what you do for the work of the Lord. I'm going to invite Pastor Dale to come up. He's going to tell you about some more exciting things that are going to happen.
Well, we're really grateful for all that's taken place in the last few weeks here. And again, thank you for your part and your prayers. And hopefully you picked a couple of these up on your way in, and there are more you can take. We're going to have an event 3 weeks from today called Back to Church Sunday. And it's a time to just welcome people who've maybe gotten out of the habit of coming to come back, for people to discover a Crane Chapel as their church family. And so it gives you a reason to invite somebody. That's one of the big things. You know, Rocky already this week showed me the program that she wants to do at Christmas. I mean, Mike and I are trying to figure out, you know, what we're going to do tomorrow, and she's planning Christmas. And so one of the things about Christmas and Easter is it's a great time to invite people to church. And from time to time, we have an event that gives you that same opportunity. Our teens have already been out inviting people to come to this. And these are door hangers. You can just leave, and this is a card you can hand somebody. We're also doing a mailing to 6,000 homes in Austin to invite them something very similar to this. So if you invite somebody and they get it in the mail, it might be like they say, I think God's talking to me. And so we want to encourage you to pray, is there somebody that I could invite? And is there maybe should I take a handful of these and go around my block? But just do what the Lord lays on your heart. And again, we're praying that people won't just find a church family, they'll find God's family. They'll find a home in heaven. And so here's an opportunity for us to do that. So thank you. Well, we're going to have Mike come and share a little bit too.
The Ark is and the Creation Museum are both amazing, and if you get the chance to go out there, do it. I would suggest flying though instead of driving. It's a very long drive, and I found out something interesting that I wasn't aware of. I do not like expansion bridges at all. The place that we stayed most of the time was probably about 5 miles from the Ohio River, and we had to cross this river at least 6 times. I did not enjoy it. Pretty much panic stricken the whole time. And the kids, of course, they were a great encouragement to me. They let me know just how high up we were. So I have asked a couple of the teens or a few of the teens to come up and share a little bit about what they experienced out there, what they liked, and if you guys would like to come up. This is Karen, Crystal, and Syrian.
Oh, hi, what's that bridge?
Very high.
Hello. The Creation Museum and the Ark were really cool. The Ark was huge. It was huge. And it talked a lot about God's mercy, like how forgiving he can be, and but also how just he could be, and how he needs to be both. Like, he can't just be you know, just forgiving all the time. He does have to put a little bit of punishment in. But we're saved. That was like a really big key point, is that we're saved.
One of my favorite things was when we did virtual reality of what it was like building the Ark. And I enjoyed this part because we were able to see the problems that Noah ran into. Instead of just knowing what happened when the flood came, we were able to actually get a virtual experience of it. And sometimes I felt like I was gonna fall out of the chair. Something that stuck out to me was the verse John 10:9, which is, "I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture." This stuck out to me because my 7-year-old sister has recently been interested in learning about God. She has come to me for help with that. For example, she asked me to pray with her and read the Bible with her. I think it is amazing how interested she is, and important for her to know that if she enters by Jesus, then she will be saved.
Good morning, everybody. The trip was an amazing experience, and like they said, Noah's Ark is really big. While we are at Noah's Ark, a verse kept sticking out to me, and it was also John 10:9. It says, "I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved, and I will go in and out and find pasture." And I just kept thinking, like, why is this verse standing out to me? And well, I realized my grandma has been sick, and doctors had told us if she didn't start eating more, she wouldn't be able to have the surgery that she needed, let alone make it past 5 days.
You want to finish reading? Yeah. Okay. It says 5 days, and at that moment, all I wanted her to know is that God had his hands open for her. Luckily, she did have the surgery and is now receiving and doing better. Recovering and doing better. So when I get the chance to speak to her, I'm going to share the verse with her and tell her she can still be saved. And the way to do that is through God, because he is the door. So we also have some pictures. Window. Okay, this here is the kids at the Creation Museum. One of the things that when you first get to the Creation Museum is you have to go through the botanical gardens. So if you notice that all the, I don't know what you call that, vegetation, plants, there we go. Oh, we're moving kind of fast here, Danny. Okay, this here is the Ark, and the thing about this was the detail. There's the door to the Ark. And this is so important because I wanted to add to what Karen and Crystal were talking about with the door. We watched a video, and the guy in this video, he talked about how Jesus is the only way into heaven. Well, the only way into that ark was that one door, you know, and everyone who entered that door was safe. The same as with everyone who enters heaven through Jesus will be safe. So you can kind of see how big that ark is there. We're quite a distance away from it. It is actually built to the dimensions of what is written in the Bible. And it is the largest wooden structure on the planet. So that's kind of cool too. One of the things I noticed right away when we were standing underneath the front of the boat was all the rivets or screws that went into holding each one of those planks. I mean, it's like, if you can imagine, has anybody seen an Airstream camping trailer? How it's just nothing but rivets. That's exactly what the ark is like. It's just full of screws, everything holding it together. And you get inside there and you see some of the beams. They used entire trees for the beams. I mean, it's just amazing. So anyway, that being said, let us pray. Dear Father God, we love you and we thank you. We thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunities that you give us. We thank you for the generous people in this congregation that have allowed us to go and do these things that we normally wouldn't be able to. We thank you for all the gifts and the blessings that we've received. Lord, we ask that you have your way in the service today, that you bless our tithes and offerings, and that you use them to increase your kingdom. We are so fortunate to see your hand at work, and we thank you, Lord, that we can be a part of the plan that you have for us. We just ask that you go with us today, and in the days to come, just keep us safe and show us your will. Give us the courage and strength to speak of you to those who don't know you, and just be with us. Allow us to love those like you love us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, as we continue in worship this morning, would you please stand with us as we open with a song, My Life is in You, Lord. Verse that kind of goes with this song is from Deuteronomy 6:5, and it says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength.
This is the power of Christ in me, from life's first cry to final breath. Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me.
Well, we really need them, don't we? Yeah. Wow. Sometimes we know it, and sometimes we forget it, but it's always true. We had folks in our church to donate about 200 hours this week to help somebody that was in a predicament. So when you think about that, that's a pretty big gift, isn't it? So thank you to all of you who helped. A mom was driving her young son to school, and he was quietly gazing out the window. And finally, he turned to her and asked, "Mom, what do they do when cars get old and junky?" She said, "Well, son, that's when your dad buys them." Evidently, they weren't quite seeing eye to eye on transportation in that family. A little frustration there. But you know, when it comes to God, we need to see eye to eye, don't we? We need to make sure we're on the same page as God, that everything He thinks is how we think. We need to make every effort to see things His way, because first of all, He isn't going to change. He's always what He is. He doesn't need to change. He's perfect. And secondly, our life works when we do it the way we were intended. Doesn't work when we try our own way, does it? Not forever, for sure. God knows what's best. And God has more strengths than we could name. Everything He does, He's the best in the world at it. And He doesn't have a single weakness. He has no limitations. He has no character flaws. There's nothing that He ever does less than perfect. And He never settles for good enough. He's always at His best. And so, He's a good person to know, and He's a good person to follow. And being perfect, He's amazingly patient with us who are not. It doesn't mean that it's okay when we sin. It just means He's not surprised, and He's got an answer for that as well. He keeps working with us. And yet there is a time when judgment falls. He holds us accountable. And in today's scripture, we're going to see God patiently interacting with someone who sincerely wants to know Him and follow Him. And we're going to see Him releasing judgment on people who just wouldn't listen, who just didn't care, who were rebellious. And in both cases, people are reaping what they've sown in their relationship with God. And so we're looking at Genesis chapter 18. It's always good if you look it up and kind of see the context around what we're talking about. Three visitors come to the camp where Abraham lives. Abraham always lived in tents all his life, moved around as a shepherd, and so went to new grazing land from time to time. And he looks out and he sees three men coming, and hospitality would mean that he went out to meet them and greet them and welcome them to his home. He had a meal prepared for them, and he sat and talked with them. And he found out that these three were angels, and they had come to see him, and they had a message for him. They told him, "Abraham, we know that you've been waiting to be a father." The truth is, 25 years before that, God had told him, "You're going to be a dad." He'd been waiting all that time. But now they came and said, "Abraham, we just want you to know, by this time next year, you're going to have a baby in your family. You and Sarah are going to have a child." Well, Abraham now was 99 years old. His wife was 89. She was inside the tent. She could hear what was being said. And when they said she was going to be a mother, she laughed. And they heard her. And one of them said, "What's so funny in there?" She said, "I didn't laugh." They said, "Oh, you did too." And the truth is, when the baby was born, his name was Laughter. That's what Isaac means. His name was Laughter. A time of joy, a time of celebration. But as his guest left, Abraham learned that one of them wasn't just an angel. He was God Himself. Probably Jesus. You say, "Well, how could he be there? He wasn't born yet." Time is nothing to God. Time, God holds time like this. It's all, He can be anywhere He wants in time. He's not in the stream that we are in. And so Abraham has a conversation with God, because he finds out God has come to judge Sodom and Gomorrah. The Lord told Abraham, I've heard that the people of Sodom and Gomorrah are extremely evil, and that everything they do is wicked. You say, well, did God have to hear that? Did somebody pass by and tell him? Well, we're on page 20 in the Bible, okay? We're just getting introduced to who God is. And he puts it very simply. He puts it in human terms, even though we know from the rest of Scripture, God knows everything, and God is everywhere, and God is able to discern every activity all at once. And so he's explaining things to Abraham very simply. The two nearby towns despise God's ways. They do whatever they want. They don't care what God has said. And now the time has come for God to deal with their rebellion. The thing about the ark is that it was, it happened in a time of judgment. And it was a way of salvation for Abraham, or for Noah and for his family and for those animals. But judgment happens because sin is real and because it's serious. And these towns had serious problems with sin. It says in another passage, Sodom's sins were pride, laziness, and gluttony, while the poor and needy suffered outside her door. She was proud and did loathsome things, and I wiped her out. Twice it says they were pride. It's one thing to sin, it's another thing to be proud of it. It's another step. It's an act of rebellion to celebrate and to be proud of doing something God says not to do. And they arrogantly did that. These towns were prosperous. They lived comfortably. But they had no interest in helping people who were not so well off. And they used their leisure to indulge themselves. You know, sometimes times are hard for us. Sometimes we have to scramble to make a living. Sometimes we're barely getting from paycheck to paycheck, and we wonder, why doesn't God make it easier? Well, sometimes when he makes it too easy, we indulge ourselves. We just try to make ourselves happy in any way we can. And if you've heard of Sodom, you probably know that they engaged in sexual sin, homosexuality, and other things that God forbids. And the Bible sternly warns us against that kind of sin. It's still wrong today, whatever people think, whatever the law of the land is. It's homosexuality is a sin. We need to be clear about that. But we also need to be clear that it's not the only sin. It's not probably the worst sin. In fact, their pride, I think, was far worse than their activity. It was pride that had that made the devil into the devil. And so we need to remember that we all are guilty of sin. And we don't have the privilege of judging other people because we're all sinners. So on one hand, we don't want to dismiss the fact that that was their sin, that was one of their sins. On the other side, we don't want to make it out like, oh, aren't we glad we're not like that? Jack Van Impe, one of the evangelists who was active a generation ago, said if God doesn't deal with America soon, he'll have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah. Because we live in a country that's guilty of pride and arrogance and self-indulgement, and we just want to do what we want to do. And so we have to be careful. Now, God created sexual desire in order to build strong families. That's where it's supposed to lead us to. And there are a lot of ways to get away from that intended purpose. And most of us manage to find one or another, don't we? At least in our minds. And so we need to be careful to call sin what it is, to repent of it, and to pray for people, not judge people. Now, these two towns deserve God's judgment, but first, Abraham had a conversation with God about that. And by the way, this passage is the first prayer recorded in the Bible. It's not the first prayer ever prayed, but the first prayer recorded. And so the law of firsts that they sometimes talk about in Bible study, it says, look at this, it'll tell you things about prayer that will continue to be true throughout Scripture. The first thing we see is prayer is a conversation. It's talking to God. And Abraham and God talk about this. Here's what it says. The other two men went on toward Sodom, but the Lord remained with Abraham for a while. Abraham approached him and said, will you destroy both innocent and guilty alike? Suppose you find 50 innocent people there within the city. Will you still destroy it and not spare it for their sakes? Why, you would be treating the innocent and the guilty exactly the same. Surely you wouldn't do that. Should not the judge of all the earth do what is right? Well, first of all, when he says innocent, he doesn't mean guiltless. He doesn't mean perfect, because there aren't any people like that. We're all sinners. Everyone sins. He's just saying, if there's 50 decent people that are trying to live a good life, are you going to destroy them with the rest? And a lot of times people do question God. Why does he allow things to happen? Why is there pain and injustice? And God doesn't take offense when we wonder, when we ask, when we come to him. You'll see it over and over in the Bible. You'll see it in the Psalms and in the prophets. Many examples of people questioning God. And he doesn't bristle with pride, like, how dare you? He doesn't get angry. He understands why things bother us. The truth is, he created us in his image. He gave us a conscience to discern right from wrong. He wants us to use that, and he doesn't take offense when we wonder, how does this all work? Sometimes our emotions run hot with God. We can be pretty angry with him. We can be pretty depressed. We can be pretty, like, we want to give up. And he understands that too. Now, it doesn't do us any good to pull away from God. It won't help us. But our questions should draw us to him, because the truth is that he cares. And he accepts us when we question. He doesn't strike out at us. He reassures us. He gives us peace when we bring our problems to him. So you can come to God with questions. It shows you care enough to want to understand. And it won't help you to run away from him, but it will help you to come to him, and he'll give you peace. He probably won't give you an outline of what he's going to do and how it all works, but he'll give you his presence. He'll give you his love. The truth is, God is a father who desires a close relationship with us. He really does. Come the way you are. Come with your questions. Come with your hopes and fears. Come with your praise and thanks. Abraham wanted to be reassured that God would be fair to Sodom and Gomorrah. One reason that he cared so much is he had a nephew who lived in that town. He was married. He had two kids. And he cared. Do you think Abraham cared more about Lot than God did? Do you think you and I care about the poor or the injustice of the world more than God does? Sometimes people get the idea that they got a better scope on things than God, that they care more than God, that they have better ideas than God, and of course that's foolish. Everything good about us came from God. And so Abraham needed to know that God would be just. But God is the one who put that in him to begin with. Of course God is going to be just. He's going to have mercy. He's going to have compassion. Far more than we ever could generate. And so God is going to have his own standard, and it's far higher than ours. So the Lord replied, if I find 50 innocent people in Sodom, I will spare the entire city for their sake. You may be the one that God is having mercy on, and others benefit from it, in your family, in your school, at work, in our nation. I mean, when you look at the sins of America, when you look at some of the things that we've done, some of the things we've done to others, You say, why hasn't God struck us? Well, because God looks and he sees godly people. He hears their prayers. He sees their desire. And God will spare the entire city of Sodom if he finds 50 people. Now, we don't know the population of Sodom. We don't know what percentage that was, 50 people. But God said he would spare the entire city. Abraham was encouraged by that, and it kind of made him bold. And he began bargaining with God. Well, is that a fixed number, or could you go a little lower? And of course, he's thinking he's got 4 family members who live there. 50, an awful lot more people than 4. And so he begins to bargain. Well, before we look at that, strictly speaking, there aren't any innocent people. Nobody's innocent. Nobody's sinless. Here's what the Bible says. God looks down from heaven on the entire human race. He looks to see if there is even one with real understanding. But no, all have turned away from God. All have become corrupt. No one does good, not even one. We're all sinners. We're born sinners. We start practicing pretty early and we never stop. The only sinless person who's ever walked on this earth is Jesus. And so, no, there aren't any innocent people. I'm not saying that if you trip and fall, you deserve it. I'm just saying that we all sin, and the consequences of sin come on all of us, rightfully. Abraham simply was vouching not for innocent people in the sense of perfection, but people who had a decent respect for God and a decent desire to honor him. Decent people. And so he progressively lowers the number of people like that would keep God from judging the whole city. Would he spare the city for the sake of 45? Well, how about 40? Lord, would you spare the city if there's 30? Well, Lord, what if there's 20? Lord, and then he says this. Finally, Abraham said, Lord, please don't get angry. I'll speak but once more. Suppose only 10 are found there. And the Lord said, then, for the sake of 10, I will not destroy it. It sounds like a teenager bargaining for an allowance, only they're trying to go up with the number. He's trying to go down, right? And he finally says, okay, God, 10 people. I know 4 by name. And God says, no, I honestly won't destroy the city. I'll give them more time. He's not saying it'll all be okay. All that they're doing is fine. But he says, I'll hold back judgment a little longer if there's 10. Well, there weren't. There weren't 10. There weren't 10. But what this prayer shows us, God's reaction shows us, is that God is merciful. He cares. Again, the Bible says, the Lord is merciful and gracious, and he's slow to get angry, and he's full of unfailing love. He has not punished us for all our sins, nor does he deal with us as we deserve. There's a reason why America is still here. There's a reason why any country in the world is still here. It's the mercy of God. It's the mercy of God. There's a reason why you and I can still walk, why we're still breathing. It's the mercy of God. If God struck us down for our sin, he'd be right doing it. But he hasn't. He's merciful. He's compassionate. He wants to restore us when we fall off the path. He wants to bring us back. He wants to make us what he intended us to be. He's willing to forgive if we'll repent. And he sent Jesus to die in our place. And here's the thing. Sin has to be punished. It has to be dealt with as evil. It is evil. Every sin is evil. Eating an apple when God said not to is evil. It's rebellion. Sin has to be punished. And so God said, I'll punish sin by punishing myself. I'll send my son God the Son, to live a perfect, sinless life, and then I'll have him get the punishment of all sin. The cross was horrible because sin is horrible. And God treated Jesus the way we deserve, so that he can treat us the way Jesus deserves. He can welcome you into his home. He can say, you're my son, you're my daughter. I love you, I care about you. I want to meet every need you have. I want to pour blessing on your life. And he treats us that way because of Jesus. We traded places, the prince and the pauper. He got treated like us, we get treated like him. And it all comes down to, will we accept that trade? Will we allow him to forgive us? Will we let him make us what we were intended to be? It looks like Abraham is pressing God for more and more of what he wants. The truth is, I believe God is encouraging him. Bring it on, Abraham. Let's see. Is that all you got? Is that all you want to ask? Do you want a little more? Because God wants him to see the depth of his heart. He wants to see the beauty of his character. And God wants us to see it. And he wants us to pray. He wants us to persevere in prayer. God's will in this world does not automatically happen. He put Adam and Eve in charge and he said, you take care of the earth. You take charge of the animals on the earth. And when you and I come along, we inherit that role. And God says to you and to me, when you pray, it will release my will. I don't know why it's set up that way. I just know it is. We need to pray. We need to persevere in prayer. And we need to pray God's will. Here's the good news. When you're praying for someone to be saved, as we just heard someone share today, you know 100% you're praying the will of God. He's not willing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. When you pray for a loved one or a friend or a schoolmate or a workmate, when you pray for a neighbor that needs Jesus, you know God wants to answer that prayer. You're praying the will of God. And when you're praying the will of God, you can pray with boldness and confidence. And somehow your prayer makes a difference. And somehow it matters. And so let's come boldly to the throne of grace, because we know that we matter to him, that the people we care about matter to him, and even the things that we care about matter to him. It matters to him. So come and pray. Pray. Well, there weren't 10 righteous people in Sodom, and so the city was destroyed. Those two angels that went ahead went to Lot's home. They took Lot and his wife and his two daughters. They took an elbow here and an elbow there, and they walked them right out of the city. They said, you got to leave, and you have to leave now. They evacuated the four and the rest of the city. By the way, the two daughters were old enough, they were engaged. And the people they were engaged to were invited to come too, and they just laughed. Why would we go? They just laughed. They laughed at Lot. And the judgment came. It says, the Lord rained down fire and burning sulfur. He utterly destroyed them. It didn't have to be that way. But they made their choices, and God made his response. And what he says happens. So we'd be wise to listen to him, care what he says. Back along this line of the nature of their sin, the bottom of your note sheet, there's just three short passages that talk about the sin of homosexuality. And as a believer, as a person who follows Christ, you need to know what the Bible says. So if you haven't ever looked that up, look it up, because our culture is saying, oh, it's not that big a deal. In fact, it's not wrong. You're a bigot if you call it a sin. You're wrong to call it that. You should be punished for saying that. We're not going around looking to fight with people. All we're doing is saying, when God speaks, we believe it. When God says something, we know it's true. And we know from our own experience of being sinners, it's not a good thing to go away from God's plan. It won't turn into happiness, success, and all the pleasure we think it'll bring us. Sin always brings bad consequences. Yeah. And so if we love people, we tell them the truth. But we don't do it as if somehow we're different, are we? We're sinners. Well, when we come to God and we pray, we want to know what's best. We want to know what's right. Paul urged believers in Philippi, he said, get close to God so that you may be able to discern what is best. God's best answer comes when we're looking for it. And he wants us to know that he will guide us if we'll pray and if we'll ask for it. So let's be people who pray. Let's pray for Afghanistan. Oh, I heard on the way to church there's something like 12 million believers in Afghanistan, more than all the people in Minnesota. Iran has millions of believers. They're under another totalitarian, hostile government. We need to pray for Haiti. We need to pray for New Orleans. We need to pray for our government and those in leadership. We need to pray for our family members, friends, neighbors, co-workers. We need to be people who pray because God will release his best plan into our lives and into the lives of others when we seek him. And you know, if you seek God, he'll give you answers. He'll show you things you wouldn't have thought of on your own. Now, I don't know if these two guys were seeking God, but there were two companies, Southwest Airlines and Stevens Aviation, that both came up with a slogan about the same time. And they advertised to people that it would be plain smart to do business with them. And one company started using it, and they saw the other company using it, and they said, hey, that was our idea, you can't use that. And the other company said, no, it was our idea, you can't use that. And so they were arguing, evidently they both thought of it, but they thought of it about the same time. And so what are you going to do? Well, the way we do that is we go to court, right? Spend a lot of money, make somebody miserable. Well, they decided not to do that. They talked it over. And they decided that they would settle the argument by having the CEO of each company come together and arm wrestle. I said, I'll arm wrestle you for the rights to this, and whoever wins, the other guy quits using it. And they said, okay. And so they got 3,000 of their employees together. They had a little party. They had something to eat. They had a good time. And then the big moment came when the two guys arm wrestled. Now, I'm guessing both of them went to some, teenage boy and said, help me practice, you know. Well, I don't know how long it lasted, and I don't remember who won, but one of them beat the other one. And immediately said, okay, I'm the winner. You can have the slogan. He had the bragging rights to the arm wrestling. What more did he want? So the other guy got the slogan, and everybody had something to eat. Went home, went back to doing what they were good at doing. Now, that sounds good to me, doesn't it, to you? That sounds like the way God would inspire people to work out a deal that doesn't really change the world anyway. And he wants to show us the best answer to every problem. He wants to show us the right thing. He wants to show us a way that builds. And not everything is that simple. Not everything can be settled making it a game. But we want God's answers. We want his best answers. And we want to be the people that do his will the best way. And so we can't play around with it. We need to be serious. We need to be intentional. We need to make up our minds that this matters to us. God matters to us. His way matters to us. God wants to show us the best way in life. So let's ask him. And let's listen, and let's do it. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. And let's sing. Nothing compares to God's plan, God's promise, God's blessing. You won't do better. His will is never a stepping stone to something else. It's the ultimate. It's the place to be. And it's not something you just step into and then you coast on. It's an onward decision. It's an everyday kind of thing where I come to God and I put myself in His hands and in His will so that He can have His way.
Yes.
It's moment by moment, isn't it? So we don't come and say, well, I settled that 20 years ago. Well, maybe we got on the right path, but we got to stay on it day by day. So let's follow Him. Amen?
Amen.
Let's seek His best. Let's lift His name the best we know how, because He deserves it. And let's point to Him, because everybody around us needs Him. Everybody. Everybody in Afghanistan, everybody in Haiti, everybody in Minnesota, everybody in between. Everybody needs Jesus, and He's there. So let's make Him known. Amen. And Father, we thank You that You love us. We're rebels. We're stubborn. We're proud of ourselves. But Lord, You love us, and You change us, and You're doing it. And we see the difference it makes in our lives as we follow Jesus. We want to follow Him all the more. And Jesus, we pray that if anyone here has never said yes to You, that they would begin that journey. And that all of us who have said yes would say it again and again and again, because You are the way, the truth, and the life. And we love You for it. And we pray in Your name. Amen.
Making of a master plan. Look up,
look up
high. What's that I see in the eastern sky? This could very well be.